I met an African lady the other day. She came from an African country. She spoke an African language. She came from an African culture. She had African customs. And she loved only African food. She had just become an American citizen. And she said, "Now, I'm a real African-American." And I thought to myself, well, where does that leave me? Did eating at the Blue Nile once a month satisfy it? Or did an African name alone satisfy it? Owning a kente cloth? Did observing all of the days of Kwanzaa satisfy it? Learning a little bit of Swahili? Or making a trip to the Gold Coast? Then I asked myself, where on the continent Africa could I go and escape being called an American? Because of my cultural characteristics. And where in the world would I want to go and escape being called an African? Because of the blood of my Asian ancestors. I conducted my own chronological investigation and applied my own analytical concepts to the subject. And it dawned on me that when the slaves were brought to America, for as long as they maintained the languages of the homeland, for as long as they maintained the traditions of the homeland, in mind, in body, and in spirit, they were Africans in America. Culturally, ethnically, biologically, Africans, geographically, Americans. Their descendants would become Americans. Culturally, Americans. Ancestrally, biologically, to a great percentage, many would remain Africans. An American African. Another page from a book called The Mental Machine. Biological derivatives from an African shore. Behind the mist of time, come, let your mind soar. Captives from African nations, the great slave ships bore. Men, women, boys, and girls, ripped from the soul of Africa's interior. The slave ships bearing Africans throughout the Americas docked, dropping human cargo from the South Atlantic up to Plymouth Rock. Africans coming to America with their customs and languages mentally locked would then give birth to the American Euro-African paradox. Some 400 years later, the years of cultural deprivation have taken their toll. From the slave yards to the graveyards to the California sands, from the cotton fields to the killing fields, from the factories to the streets, up here stranded in the north, south, east, and west, are millions of American Africans. An American African. Another page from a book called The Mental Machine.
Ladies and gentlemen, Alex Haley.
When I was a little boy, I lived in a little town of which you never heard probably, called Henning, Tennessee, about 50 miles north of Memphis. I lived there in the home of my mother's mother, my grandmother, who was very close to me and I to her. And my warmest, earliest memories include that every summer, my grandmother, who was widowed, would invite to her home various women members of the family. They came from places which, in the context of a little boy from Henning, Tennessee, sounded very exotic, like Inkster, Michigan, St. Louis, Dyersburg, Tennessee, Kansas City, places such as that. They had names such as Cousin Georgia, Great Aunt Liz, Great Aunt Till, Great Aunt Viney, and others. And they would come there. Some would stay for just a couple of weeks when they arrived. Others would stay for the whole of the summer, depending on whatever their family situations permitted. And my earliest memories include that every single evening across those summers, after supper, as we call the evening meal, when the dishes had been washed, these ladies, who generally averaged about my grandmother's age range, late 40s, early 50s, would go out from the kitchen and kind of filter out onto the front porch. They would each take seats in cane-bottom rocking chairs, and they would begin rocking back and forth. When they all got going, it was like so many metronomes, just rocking. In time terms, it would be about as dusk deepened into early evening, lightning bugs flickering around over the honeysuckle vines just beyond the porch. And they would talk each evening, unless there was some local gossip to supersede it temporarily. They would talk about the self-same thing. It was a long narrative history of a family, although I didn't know that as a little boy. It was not a verbatim thing, but bits and pieces and patches which were told together kind of in a mixed, homogenized way about this family. They would speak about people. They would speak of places, speak of things. And I, as a little boy, didn't have the orientation to understand a great deal that they'd talk about. For instance, when they spoke of people and they talked about an old massa, I didn't know what an old massa was. I didn't know what an old missus was. When they spoke about places and they mentioned a plantation, I didn't know what that was, although after a while I began to get some impression it must be something rather like a farm from the things I heard being done on them. And I know that my first impression or awareness as a little boy that whatever they were talking about and whomever they were talking about went a long way back would come when every now or then one of these old ladies would get talking animatedly about something which had happened in her girlhood. And it would come sooner or later that one of them would kind of abruptly turn about in her chair and sort of fling her hand down toward me behind my grandmother's chair where I always sat and exclaimed something like, I wasn't any bigger than this young'un here. And the very idea that someone as old and wrinkled and gray as they had once been no older or bigger than I was just blew my mind. I could hardly believe that. But it gave me the impression that whatever they were talking about was something which went a long way back. When they were speaking of people, the furthest back person they ever would speak of was someone whom they called the African. They would tell how this African was brought on a ship to this country to a place which they pronounced as Naples. And they would tell how he was bought off that ship by a man whom they called Massa John Waller, who took this African to his plantation in a place which they described as Spotsylvania County, Virginia. And they told how there this African desperately kept trying to escape. The first three times he escaped, he was caught, brought back, and each time given a worse beating than previously as his punishment. And then the fourth time he escaped, this time he had the misfortune to be caught by a pair of professional slave catchers. I have since done some peripheral research on that profession. I think it's safe to say that there has never been a more bestial profession ever walked the face of this country. The story went that these men cornered this African who had escaped for the fourth time, and he, in his desperation, hurled a rock which hit one of them in the head and wounded the man rather badly. Nonetheless, they were able to overwhelm him, and then the story was that they brought him back before a group of other slaves who had escaped fewer times than he, and apparently one because he had injured one of them, and two because he was such a repetitive escapee that he set up a very glaring bad example in the course of slavery at that time. He was given an exemplary punishment, or in fact choice of punishments. It was told that he was given the choice before the others either of being castrated or of having a foot cut off. And this African chose the foot. The story was that his foot was put on a stump and with an axe was cut off across the arch. It was a hideous act. It was by no means a necessarily uncommon act in the course of antebellum slavery. As it would turn out, it was going to play a very major role in the keeping intact of the history of a black family down across literally generations. That would play out against one major background fact, and that was that slaves had very little sense of that which we today know value and treasure as family continuity. And the principal reason that they did not was because slaves tended to be sold back and forth enough that on the average, when those who were of parent age had children, very often those children grew up knowing little, if indeed anything at all, about their parents, which is to say that many parents were sold away from children too young to have remembered their parents. And then when those children grew up, and in turn had children, there was yet less that they could pass on to their children. So over a period of successive generations, it came to be that slaves as a body were characterized with appreciably less and less knowledge of family lineage or heritage as we know it. And in this time, when this was the case, when this particular African whose foot had been cut off managed first to survive, then to convalesce, he posed now to his master an economic question. Slavery was, after all, an economic matter viewed in that perspective by those who were owners of slaves. The master apparently decided that although he was crippled and he hobbled about, he could do limited work, and that he would be more valuable doing that limited work than if he were sold away at one of the auctions held periodically in the area. Because had he been sold at auction, he automatically, in his condition, would have been sold at what was called a scrap sale at the end of auctions, when those who were variously ill, incapacitated, or otherwise not so physically desirable were sold for quite low prices, as a rule. So it happened that in a time when slaves were characterized by very little knowledge of self in lineage terms, this particular African, by his master's decision, was kept on one plantation for what was going to turn out to be quite a long period of time. Limping, hobbling about, working as best he could in the vegetable garden where he had been assigned, this African, in time, met and mated with another slave there on that plantation in Spotsylvania County, Virginia. And in the stories told by my grandmother and Aunt Liz and Cousin George and Aunt Plus and Aunt Viney and the rest of them, she was described as Belle, the big house cook. And of this union was born a little girl, and she was given the name Kizzy. As the little girl Kizzy grew up, it was said that when she got to be 4 or 5 or so and could begin to understand such things, this African father of hers, every chance he got, would take the little girl, his daughter, by the hand and lead her about the plantation. He would point out to her various natural objects, a tree, a rock, the sky, a cow, a chicken, anything of this nature. And every time he'd point out any such object to his daughter, he would tell her the name for that thing in his native tongue. And the little girl, Kizzy, like any child today hearing an alien tongue spoken, heard and learned strange phonetic sounds. Gradually, with repetitive hearing of them and repetition of them on her own part, she memorized these sounds and she came to associate certain sounds with certain objects. For instance, it was said that there was in the slave quarters a stringed instrument of a sort which was in some places called a kwakwa. It kind of roughly resembled, say, a banjo or maybe loosely speaking a guitar or something. And it was said that every time this African would point to this instrument with his daughter in tow, he would say to her, Ko, as if it was spelled K-O, a single syllable. And the little girl, Kizzy, came to know that in her African father's terms, that stringed instrument meant Ko. There were numerous other sounds for other objects that he would point out from time to time. Perhaps the most involved of the objects or sounds that he would point out a make with her was that there was a river which ran nearby this plantation in Spotsylvania County, Virginia. The river, in fact, was the Mattapony River. And it was said that whenever this African would point to this river with his daughter present, he would say to her, Kambi Bolongo. And she came to know that strange phonetic sound. and to know that to him, her father, it meant river. There was about this African something which was characteristic of all those Africans who were brought from Africa and bought off slave ships and taken to plantations. When they were taken to plantations, about the very first act in the case of virtually every one of them was that they were given an anglicized name. And for all practical purposes, that was the first step in the psychic dehumanization of an individual or collectively of a people. The removal from the individual of the native name with which went his or her subjective sense of self-identity, the same as it is with us today, whatever may happen to be our names. In the case of this African, he was given by his master the name Toby. But it was said that on that plantation that every time any of the other slaves would address him as Toby, he would strenuously rebuff and reject it and tell them that his name was Kinte, a sharp, two-syllabic, angular sound Kinte, which the little girl Kizzy came to know was, her father said, his name. There was about this African yet another thing, again characteristic of all those Africans who were the ancestors of all we black people here in this auditorium or here in this country. And that was that every single one of them had been torn from some place where they had spoken whatever was their native tongue, and they had been brought to this place where it was a matter of necessity that they learned to speak as quickly as possible what was for them a strange, alien, new tongue, English. Gradually, haltingly, a word here, a phrase there, those Africans learned to speak this new tongue English in their own individualistic way that we now call idiom, a dialect, or some such. And as this process happened with this particular African, he began now with a little wider range in the language that his daughter better understood, English, to tell her little anecdotes, stories about himself. As a matter of fact, it would appear he had a passion for trying to communicate to his daughter a sense of his past. Among the stories he told her was how he had been captured. He said that he had been not far away from his village, chopping wood, intending to make himself a drum, when he had been surprised, set upon, overwhelmed, and thus had been kidnapped into slavery. And the little girl, Kizzy, came to know that story that her father told, among other stories that he told. To compress what would happen on that plantation in Virginia over the next 5 years and then further along, the girl Kizzy stayed there growing up on the plantation, directly exposed to her African father, to his stories and to his sounds, until at the age of 16, Kizzy was sold away. She was sold away to a new master. His name was Tom Lee, L-E-A. He had a much smaller plantation in Caswell County, North Carolina. And it was on that plantation that within her first year there, the young woman Kizzy gave birth to her child, a boy who was given the name George. The father, or at least the sire, was the new master Tom Lee, which was not at all an uncommon situation in the antebellum South. As it would turn out, when this boy George got to be 4 or 5 or so and began to ask the obvious question about who was his father, his mother, Kizzy, rather than tell him the truth that the master was his father, began instead to tell him about her father. And so this boy, among others that he had contact with, began boastfully to talk about his grandfather, this African, who said his name was Kinte, who called a guitar Ko, who called a river Kambi Bolongo, who said that he had been chopping wood intending to make a drum when he'd been captured, and all the rest of the story as it had come down from his mother Kizzy. In the pattern of slaving at the time, when the boy George got to be about 12 years of age, he now was apprenticed to an old slave to learn a useful occupation. In his case, the old slave was Uncle Mingo, who handled the master's fighting gamecocks. The fighting of gamecocks in the antebellum South was a sport comparable in popularity to, say, the basketball or football or baseball among us today. And this young boy, it seems, together with whatever Uncle Mingo was able to teach him, seemed to have a kind of innate green thumb-like ability for this sport, to the degree that by the time he was in his mid-teens, he had been given by others involved in the sport the nickname that would stick indelibly to him for the rest of his long life, and that was Chicken George. When Chicken George got to be about 18, he met the young slave woman with whom he later would mate. Her name was Matilda. And in time, Matilda was going to give birth to 8 children. And now it was Chicken George in the role of father who set into motion what was later going to become a rigid family tradition that every time one of those infants was born, Chicken George, in a formal way, would gather the family within the slave cabin. He would sit with the new infant on his lap, and speaking ostensibly to the infant, but actually to his older audience, he would tell the story which had come down from his mother, Kizzy. And for that eventual 8 children of Chicken George and Matilda, it was something most unusual in the knowledge of slave children, and that was direct knowledge of a great-grandfather, this same African who said his name was Kinte, who called a river Kambibolongo, a guitar Ko, who said that he had been chopping wood to make a drum when he was captured, and all the rest of the story that had come down from Kizzy to her son. As fate would have it, those children grew up and took mates and had children in the way that things happen. The fourth child of Chicken George and Matilda, Tom, would become a blacksmith. He was sold away in his latter teens to a man whose name was Murray, who had a tobacco plantation in Alamance County, North Carolina. And it was on that plantation that Tom, the blacksmith, in time met and mated with a young slave woman whose name was Irene. She was half black, half Cherokee Indian. She came from the Edwin Holt plantation in another section of Alamance County, North Carolina. And in time, also Irene was going to give birth to 8 children. And now it was Tom, the blacksmith in the father role, who carried on the tradition begun by his father, that every time one of those children was born, he too would gather the family in a formal way within the slave cabin, and he would sit with the new infant on his lap and tell the story that had come down. And for the second set of 8 children, hearing this story, it was something all but unheard of in the knowledge of slave children on the average, and that was direct knowledge of a great-great-grandfather, this same African who said his name was Kinte, who called a kwakwa guitar Ko, who called a river Kambibolongo, who said that he had been chopping wood to make a drum when he'd been captured, and the rest of the story as it had come down. As things would turn out, of that second set of 8 children hearing about this African great-great-grandfather, the youngest was a little girl whose name was Cynthia. And as fate was further to have it, Cynthia was to become my maternal grandma. And I told you at the outset how I grew up in my grandma's home in Little Henning, Tennessee, and she pumped that story into me as if it were plasma. It was by all odds the most precious thing in her life, the story of the family which had come down across the generations in the manner I have described. I stayed around grandma's until I was around in my early teens, by which time I had 2 younger brothers, George and Julius. Our father by this time had finished getting his master's degree at Cornell University in agriculture, and he had begun to teach at small black land-grant colleges about the South, and we were kind of faculty brats here or there wherever he was teaching. And then, when World War II came along, I, the oldest of the 3 sons, was one of the many, many young men who thought that if I could hurry up and get into the U.S. Coast Guard, an organization of which I had recently heard, that maybe I could spend the war walking the coast somewhere. And I managed to get into it, and to my great shock, rather suddenly discovered myself on an ammunition ship in the Southwest Pacific. It was not at all what I'd had in mind. And when I look back on it now, however, it seems to have been part of a meant-to-be series of incidents that one day I would write a book called Roots. Going back, the series of incidents began with Grandma having told me that story in the first place and the other elderly ladies of the family. And then the next thing would be, as I look back upon it, if I was one day to write a book, obviously I had to become a writer, something I had never thought about. It was not the kind of thing to which one aspired if one was brought up in Little Henning, Tennessee and whatnot. The way I got to be a writer was completely accidental, looked at in one aspect, and then from another aspect, it seems to me also to have been intended that these things would happen. We would be at sea, about sometimes as much as 2 months at a time. The biggest problem we had was not the enemy. It was just sheer boredom of evenings when your day's work was done and there you were out there in the middle of the Southwest Pacific with nothing to do at night. There was a running poker game, a running crap game, and other things, and I didn't do either of those things very well, and it just sort of happened. I became a cook on the ship, and in the evenings, after I had washed my pots and pans from the evening meal, I would generally go down in the hold of the ship and get my most precious possession, a portable typewriter. I had learned in high school to type. And I would write letters. I just began writing letters to all my ex-schoolmates, even teachers, anybody I would write letters to. And every now and then, ships would come out to us, bringing mail to us from home, and they would take our mail and take it ashore where it would be mailed. And once I got things going pretty well, every mail call that we had, I would get 40, 50 letters at a time. I rather swiftly got imaged on the ship as its most prolific correspondent. Now, this was playing directly into a series of things that would lead into my becoming a writer one day, way down the line from there. Being at sea as long as we were, and as far away from home as we were, when we finally would get ashore, generally some port in Australia or New Zealand, bunch of lusty young sailors that we were, and some fairly lusty older ones as well, I don't really have to tell you what was our topmost priority when we got ashore. We would go and we would do the best we could, and then pretty soon... and then pretty soon we'd been back out at sea. And now there would be all these fellas who were smitten with the memory of some young lady they'd left ashore. And girls have a way of getting all the more lissom and voluptuous in your mind the longer you stay at sea. And it got to be that some of my buddies, who were generally what we might call, using a colloquialism, the great rapper types, the very vocal types, they were not awfully hot on paper, however, began to come around and ask me, because they knew I wrote so many letters, if I would help them write a letter to some girl or other. And I was, of course, glad to do it if I could. And so they set up a practice, just accidentally began to happen in the ways that things can happen in the service, where each evening at just about this time, I would sit at a mess table in the mess deck with a stack of 3x5 cards in front of me, and my clients would literally line up. And as they got to me one by one, I would interview them about this girl. I'd say, okay, now what's she look like? Hair, eyes, mouth, nose, whatnot. What did you say to her? Where did you go with her? What do you want to say to her now? Is there anything special, such as that? And whatever he told me, I would reduce to tight little notes on an index card. And then later, as I got a chance, I'd take each of these cards with his and her name on it, and using that specific information about that young lady, I would write a personalized sort of love letter for him to copy in his own handwriting. And it would be something like, say, almost all my clients were white. If the guy told me, as many did, the girl's hair was blonde, well, out there in the middle of the ocean, I'd get in some fit of creativity and come up with something like, your hair is like the moonlight reflected on the rippling waves, or stuff like that. And these girls would get these letters, and I will never forget one day and night that would prove very pivotal in my being a writer this night. We had been at sea a little over 2 months, during which time 3 batches of mail had gone off our ship ashore, so that each of my clients' girls had had these many letters. And we got in, after 2 months at sea, into the city of Brisbane, Australia. Liberty was declared that evening at 6. Everyone who had liberty just flew ashore. By midnight, most of them had come wobbling, stumbling back to the ship, having accomplished the most they had been able on such short notice, which was to get drunk. And they were just alcoholically imbibed. They were just plain drunk. But then, with my clients, it was almost as if a script had been written. Around 1 in the morning, they began to come back individually, and each of them, before a steadily enlarging and increasingly awestruck audience, were describing in the graphic ways that only young sailors can how when he got to that young lady behind these letters I had written for him, that he just met with astounding results practically on the spot. And I... and I became heroic that night on that ship. And I can tell you the truth that for the rest of World War II, I never fought a soul. All I did was write love letters. And, and that was when I began trying to write stories for magazines. It was how I began while a sailor on ships at sea to write, it would turn out, some part of every day, 7 days a week for the next 8 years, collecting in time hundreds of rejection slips before finally I was selling things to small magazines and then to some others. I stayed on in the service until I was 37 years of age when I had 20 years and then I retired. I went to New York, I went to Greenwich Village, rented a room in a basement, and there I began to have a very rough time trying to make it as a full-time freelance writer. It would come to be in time, however, I began to get assignments from the Reader's Digest on a fairly regular basis, and I would do biographical articles for them. And then in a big switch, I went over from the Reader's Digest to Playboy, where I happened to begin the feature called the Playboy Interviews. The first of them, would interest you probably to know, was when I was given an assignment to do an article about the great genius jazz trumpeter Miles Davis. And I was having a great deal of problem with that story, and the main reason for it was that Miles talked so little. One day I was talking with a friend of his, and it was brought out to me that Miles was as good a cook as he is a trumpeter. And the thing came to pass that I just had a hard time getting him to say anything. To give you an example, if you were home and a friend of Miles, one afternoon, say around 6:30, your phone would ring and you'd pick it up and say hello. And a voice would come over and say, "Chili," and hang up. And the translation of that was that Miles had cooked chili and that you should come over that evening and have some.
Deep breath when they say we have a vaccine. That's when it is over. That's when it is over. That's when it is over.
Do not ever leave home without your mask. Do not ever cook food for you or anyone else without your mask. Do not serve food without your mask. Do not talk to anyone without your mask. And that's 6 feet away. The 6 foot distancing from another person is not a substitute for wearing your mask. It's plus wearing your mask. What are the consequences of not staying 6 feet apart? It could be a decision to stay 6 feet apart or being 6 feet under. The safest place for you is at home. If you must leave home, keep a 6 foot distance from whomever you encounter. Wash your hands constantly. Do not touch your face. Wear disposable gloves wherever you go. Dispose of those gloves once you're back in your safe location. Good friends keep good friends 6 feet away, so they can live to see another day. That is the new meaning of friendship. The telephone is the new handshake and the new hug. I give 6 foot fist pumps for days, 6 feet away.
That's when it is over. That's when it is over. That's when it is over.
Hold on tight. Don't let go. Whenever you feel like you're nearing the end of your rope, don't slide off. Tie a knot. Keep hanging. It's not about how strong you are. It's about how vulnerable the people you love might be.
That's That's when it is over.
So, as hard as it is, stay home, unless it's absolutely necessary to go out, stay home.
Okay, when do we get there? 12 months to 18 months. When they say we have a vaccine. That's when it is over.
You're listening to Electrifying Mojo, Rare Moments. If you like this video, hit the like button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button. If you like this video, hit the like button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button.